Today we will start with hemolytic anemia. Before starting, first of all we will have some review about classifications of anemia. One of the most common causes of anemia is the blood loss. Then there will be basically two main causes. Either anemia is decreasing hemoglobin concentration according to their age and sex or other any special condition. Basically, there are two main causes. One is the increased destruction of the RBCs, which is known as hemolytic anemia, or we can say this hemolysis. Number two is there will be decreased production of the RBCs. So, among the hemolysis or increased hemolytic anemia, main causes are inherited genetic defects, among which we have red cell disorders, hereditary spherocytosis, and enzyme deficiency, which is the glucose 6 phosphate deficiency. Then there will be hemoglobin, structural hemoglobin disorders when there is decreased synthesis of the globulin chains, thalassemias, and there will be some structurally abnormal globins, such as sickle cell anemia. Then there are acquired genetic defects which leads to hemolysis, among which there is PNH, antibody mediated destruction, there is trauma, and etc. And the second group is decreased red cell production, among which there is the inherited disorders. There are some nutritional disorders. We already have discussed this classification. That's why I'm not going in details. And there are certain conditions like where there is decreased production of RBCs due to other diseases, like there is renal failure which leads to erythropoietin deficiency, and certain infections like parvovirus, B12 infection. And some conditions there which what happened, there will be bone marrow infiltrated by abnormal cells, which is like malignant cells. It may be any carcinoma, etc. By which case, abnormal cells will accumulate inside the bone marrow, and the normal erythropoietic cells will be decreased, which leads to decreased production of the specific cell line. It may be RBCs, WBCs, platelets. So it may be single cytopenia or pancytopenia. Today, our main topic of discussion will start with hemolytic anemia. What happened in hemolytic anemia? Basically, normal RBC's lifespan is 120 days. In hemolytic anemia, there will be premature destruction of the red cells. Red cells are normal, it's a lifespan become decreased and they start. Their destruction starts at a rapid rate. What happened in the starting of the hemolytic anemia? When there is increased destruction of the RBCs, bone marrow respond it by increase their RBCs production. This is known as compensatory increase in erythropoiesis. But in the start of hemolysis, as the rate of destruction of the RBCs increase, there will be corresponding increase in production of the RBCs or production of the erythropoiesis increase in the bone marrow. But then there came a time when the rate of destruction of the RBCs, that is hemolysis, exceeds the bone marrow capacity of producing new RBCs. At that point, it leads to anemia. Now, the second thing is when there is increased destruction of the RBCs, there will be increased accumulation of the hemoglobin degradating products, which are the basically there is extravascular hemolysis, and number two is the intravascular hemolysis. In extravascular hemolysis, what happened? The deformed red blood cells is when passing through liver, spleen, and bone marrow, there will be phagocytosis. This condition leads to anemia, jaundice, and splenomegaly. While in intravascular hemolysis, RBCs are broken down inside the vessel. It leads to hemoglobinemia, hemoglobinuria, hemosiderinuria, and jaundice. General features of hemolytic anemia kya hai? What are these? First of all, increased red cell production destruction. Increase when there will be destruction of the RBCs, there will be increase in unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia, which leads to mild jaundice. There will be increased risk of gallstones. There will be increase in urinary and fecal urobilinogen. And what happened? There will be decrease haptoglobin and hemopexis. In extravascular hemolysis, there will be increase in iron stores and splenomegaly, while as in intravascular hemolysis, RBCs are broken down inside the vessel, so it directly leads to hemoglobinemia, and when these are filtered through the kidney, there will be hemoglobinuria and some of the hemosiderinuria and methemoglobinemia. Because iron is going out of the body, there will be body iron stores will be decreased. Number second, as there will be compensatory increase in red cell production, what happened in the bone marrow, there will be increased erythropoiesis. ME ratio will be reversed. Normally, this ratio will, there will be more myeloid component as compared to erythroid component. But what happened in this, there will be more erythropoiesis, there will be more erythroid component, and this ratio become 1:1 or less than 1. Increased reticulocytosis. Premature RBCs coming out of the bone marrow. This is represented as polychromasia. Due to increased production of the RBCs, folate requirement of the body will increased, and it leads to macrocytosis. This is a diagram. Decreased hemoglobin, increased bilirubin and LDH level. Fatty count will be increased due to increased number of newly formed RBCs. This is the hemolytic anemia. Now what we will do, whenever there will be these three things, decreased HP, increased bilirubin or LDH level, increased reticular count, which is the hemolytic anemia, first of all we will do DAT, Coombs test, to exclude autoimmune hemolytic anemia. If it is negative, then we will see other hemolytic anemias. If it is positive, then we will say it is autoimmune hemolytic anemia. This is basically a simple diagram shows how we will diagnose different hemolytic anemias. Before going into details, we will discuss it later. Today we will start with hereditary spherocytosis. It is hemolytic anemia with red cell membrane defect. This is autosomal dominant disorders. There will be intrinsic defect in the red cell membrane skeleton, which renders the cells spheroids, and they become less deformable and leads to splenic sequestration and destruction. This is a basic skeleton framework. There are two spectrin chain, which is alpha and beta. They combine with corresponding two other chains and form the spectrin tetramer. It combines with ankyrin, and there will be some horizontal and vertical interactions, which leads to stability of the RBCs. Hereditary spherocytosis caused by mutation which leads to insufficiency of membrane skeleton component. It can be chiral protein, band 3 spectrin or band 4.2. It decreases the normal lifespan of RBCs to 10 to 20 days. It is the autosomal dominant disorders. What happened? That deficiency of membrane skeleton reduces the stability of the lipid bilayer. Loss of the membrane fragment leads to decrease in membrane loss of the membrane relative to cytoplasm, which gives them possible smallest diameter for a given volume, and it forms the spherocytes. These are the spherocytes. You can see these are spherocytes, these cells. What happened? Primary defect in skeletal membrane, decreased membrane stability. There will be loss of the portion of membrane, decreased surface volume, decreased deformability. When RBCs become less deformable while passing through the spleen, there will be sequestration and leads to extracellular hemolysis, which is the extravascular hemolysis. Main clinical features of hereditary spherocytosis is anemia, splenomegaly, jaundice, gallstone. These all are the features of extravascular hemolysis as well. When there will be destruction of the RBCs inside the spleen, this is known as extravascular hemolysis. And when there will be infection, these patients are prone to infection with parvovirus. It leads to aplastic crisis. Aplastic crisis means there will be decreased production of the RBCs in the bone marrow. These patients also present with hemolytic crisis. In certain infections, there will be increased rate of destruction leads to hemolytic crisis. How we will diagnose these patients on history? There will be history of anemia, aplastic crisis, hemolytic crisis, jaundice. On examination, we can have splenomegaly, gallstones, screening test. What are the screening tests? This is the HP of the patient will be decreased, creatinine count will be increased, bilirubin levels will be increased, LDH level will be increased. Specific test for hereditary spherocytosis is osmotic fragility test. We will discuss about this test in detail in our some next lectures. This is a simple hemolytic anemia. When there is that test is positive, it is autoimmune. When it is negative, then we go for further testing. When on the blood CP, free blood picture, MCHC of the cell will be increased, it is goes towards the hereditary spherocytosis. It has some general treatment of the infection, hemolytic crisis in case of decreased RBCs, decreased HP, we can lead to blood transfusion, or in case of there will be gallstones and repeated episodes of hemolysis, we can also go for splenectomy. So basically, hereditary spherocytosis in autosomal dominant disorders, patient presented with anemia, and fluctuating jaundice. Jaundice will due to increased production of unconjugated bilirubin. It leads to splenomegaly and pigmented gallstones. Patient has increased reticulocytosis. On blood CP, patient has microspherocytosis, and that will be negative. Thank you.